What is the formula for becoming a champion? Is success part of the equation? Are two-a-days and talent the key variables? Or is the whole greater than the sum of its parts? Perhaps it takes a certain amount of pride and determination, a commitment to yourself and your brothers to become better than you ever thought you could be. For the Iowa High School Yellow Jackets, being a champion takes all of this and more. This is our story. This is one team, one town, one goal. Welcome to Jesse Cady Memorial Stadium, everybody. This is Iowa High School Yellow Jacket Football. Iowa came into the Crowley game fueled by two encouraging preseason performances against Leesville and Jennings. A win now over this strong 3A opponent would give the Jackets the momentum to carry them into a productive early season. Iowa's offense moved effectively in the first half and kept them in the game, in spite of a costly first quarter turnover. Unfortunately, Crowley's persistent defense, coupled with more Jacket turnovers, would add up to a rare opening game loss. Iowa returned home to face the Welsh Greyhounds in week two. Early season mistakes were corrected as the Jackets found the end zone early and often. All Welsh found was a speedy Iowa defense that constantly shut down the run and forced key turnovers. Both offense and defense produced several big plays for the Yellow Jackets. They had found their momentum and were ready to move ahead. Anticipation of Week 3's matchup between Iowa and Sam Houston had been building since the final seconds of last year's game. The 2005 meeting between the Jackets and the Broncos had been considered an instant classic. Now all eyes were on Southwest Louisiana's newest and perhaps biggest rivalry, waiting to see if the 2006 game would indeed be what had been touted as Coach Sutherland's homecoming. Iowa struck first and struck hard, putting up three first-half scores before Sam Houston could respond. Playing like giants, the Jackets faced down every challenge that the Broncos threw at them. Though Sam Houston was able to substitute more often throughout the game, keep it fresh against an Iowa team that had many starters playing both ways, they never outplayed the Yellow Jackets. Iowa constantly came up with important stops in the second half, though many players were exhausted and dealing with cramps and minor injuries. Even though Sam Houston threatened to make a late comeback, they could not overcome Iowa's lead, and they definitely could not measure up to Iowa's heart. In Week 4, Iowa faced what is known as a trap game. When a seemingly weaker opponent meets an emotionally drained team after an important win, rain looked to sneak into Iowa and steal a win from a Jacket team that was fast approaching a tough district schedule. Rain scored first, but Iowa scored most, earning points from every side of the ball. The offense had its run of the field, while the defense converted turnovers into easy scores, and special teams combined speed and heavy hitting to put even more points on the board. The Rain Wolves collapsed under the relentless assault poured on by Iowa. On a cold, rainy evening, the Yellow Jackets enjoyed the warm comfort of a satisfying victory. After the convincing win over the Rain Wolves, Iowa traveled down the highway to John J. Mims Stadium to meet the LaGrange Gators. The Gators, though coming off a losing season in 2005, were known for having large, speedy athletes and regarded as being a team about to take a turn for the better. A new coaching staff had breathed new life into LaGrange High, and both the Gators and their opponents knew that any game could be the breakout game. Highway didn't even flinch. The Jackets exploded ahead 26-0 in the first half, moving the ball easily down the field, mixing a slashing running game with tight, efficient passing. The Jacket defense choked out the running game and forced turnovers when LaGrange tried to go to the air. Iowa pressured the Gator quarterbacks with a relentless pass rush and quick coverage in the defensive backfield. Iowa entered district play exactly where they wanted to be, in control and moving fast. Iowa's convincing wins over the prior 3 weeks had people talking about a possible district championship. With Jennings ranked and enjoying early success, the outcome of Week 6's game had the possibility of affecting, even determining, the outcome of the district race. Though Iowa had won easily against their early season opponents, they knew not to underestimate Jennings. The Bulldogs had also enjoyed recent victories and had given Iowa a fight in the preseason. The game could easily go to either team. Iowa made the first key play of a tight contest midway through the second quarter with a goal line stand that swung the momentum of the game in favor of the Yellow Jackets. They then scored two quick touchdowns late in the second quarter to take a lead into halftime. A critical third quarter touchdown would be the difference in the game as Iowa held off a late comeback by the Bulldogs to take control of the district race. Iowa returned to Mims Stadium the following week to play the St. Louis Saints for the first time in 2 years. Tensions ran high between the two teams. Iowa's last district loss was to St. Louis in 04, and last year's rematch was interrupted by Hurricane Rita. All offers for a makeup game had been declined by the Saints, an apparent dodge that left the Jackets hungry for a fight with this now bitter rival. Two touchdown drives by Iowa early in the first half gave the appearance of an easy Jacket victory. But St. Louis came back time and time again with a strong passing attack. In a game that saw four lead changes, the outcome was in doubt until the waning seconds of the fourth quarter. Iowa prevailed thanks in a large part to a career performance by tailback Mike Vital and a never-say-die attitude. The Jacket fans found much to celebrate, while the rowdy Saints crowd had to hang their heads and say, maybe next year. Iowa finally stumbled against Eunice in Week 8. The Bobcats' front seven pressured Iowa's running game and forced eight turnovers and one safety, which ultimately made the difference in the game. In spite of their mistakes, the Yellow Jackets fought hard on both sides of the ball. The defense came through time and again to fight off Eunice's attempts at scoring and kept victory within reach until the final seconds ticked off the clock. Whether it was due to fatigue from the previous week's loss or the accumulation of several significant injuries over the season, the Yellow Jackets never found an answer to Lake Charles Boston's powerful running game in their Week 9 matchup. The Cougars, a traditionally weak team, came to Iowa sharp and well-coached, making their last year in Class 3A a memorable one for their fans and a painful one for several teams on their schedule. Iowa took a step back in their pursuit of the district crown. The following game would be crucial if they were to claim at least part of a title. With Iowa coming off a loss and Westlake enjoying their first winning season in 2 years, neither team seemed to have a clear advantage. Iowa had to win in order to have a chance at a district title, and Westlake looked to create a three-way tie for first in district with a win over Iowa and a Jennings loss to St. Louis. A sluggish first quarter suggested an Iowa hangover from the recent losses. However, following the lead of a determined offense and a vicious defense, Iowa surged back to victory over their biggest rival. For the fourth year in a row, Iowa finished with at least a share of first place and a home playoff game. The playoffs brought the start of a new season for the Jackets. Iowa's record set up a first-round home game against the Richwood Rams. With a win at home, Iowa could face a weak Bogalusa team, which had upset Carr, a Class 3A powerhouse, the night before. The doors were wide open to make a run deep into the playoffs. As expected, Iowa put up a tremendous effort, playing with heart and pride. However, early turnovers proved costly, giving the Rams two scores that eventually made all the difference in the game. The Jackets could not overcome the points that they surrendered and watched their season come to an end all too early. What is the formula for being a champion? Is being the best really the only measure of a successful season? Are victories the only mark of a winner? Or is it enough simply to challenge yourself to go farther than you thought you could, aim higher than you ever imagined, and push yourself past your limits, knowing that in the end, when you look into the mirror, a winner looks back at you? For 5 years now, Iowa has settled for nothing less than the best. This is their legacy, their team, and their goal. This is Iowa football, and the future looks bright.
Get your stuff in. My wife got me some good dinner.